Today, we found ourselves in my former print cave. The printers from here have moved into the studio, but I'm keeping the dirtier tools here in the basement. And one of those tools is the Sienci Labs Mill One CNC router, which for the rest of this video I call Bob for stupid but obvious reasons. Bob is a moving bed CNC router, kind of similar to the Carbide 3D Nomad, and as is, it was okay, it was usable for light wood cutting and so on, but there were a few things that were bothering me about it, and in my mind, if I fix those, I will be able to use it at least for cutting aluminum, and that would make it a massively more useful machine for me. The folks making this open source machine were happy to see some mods, so I went at it, and now it does cut aluminum, sort of, but better than before. So let's go through what issues I tried to fix, what worked, and what didn't. This video is sponsored by you. Thank you to everyone who's supporting the channel directly through Patreon and YouTube memberships, and to everyone who's watching these videos with your adblock disabled, or even just subscribes and likes. That's actually super helpful. Learn more about what keeps this channel going at the link in the description below. Okay, let's get going with the end brackets here. So Bob has a pretty sleek build with three axes that are built similarly, but also use identical printed parts. I mean, for 3D printed parts, they don't really need to be identical, but still, it's cool to see that multi-function built in. So it's a main aluminum profile that they've got some open builds wheels running on, a lead screw in the center, some sort of a carriage that runs on it, and then these end brackets at the end that either bolt the track to the frame, as they do on this end, or hold a stepper motor to drive the lead screw, or both, you know. Now, these are the original brackets, and with those, the X and Y axis, so about this and about that axis, they were just super easy to twist about, and you could see the profile actually sliding on the MDF frame. Of course, flex like that is deadly for cutting any sort of harder material, and since there is still plenty of flex in the other parts, like after fixing this, this still isn't super rigid. Trying to make this machine as rigid as possible is kind of important. My simple fix for these brackets is adding two more bolt holes as little ears. You can see them back here and up front here, and these actually fit in all the places where the original part is used. On top of the Z-axis, it would look a bit silly with those two extra ears sticking out, but you know, with two extra holes drilled on the X and Y axes, those are already significantly stiffened up. You know, I could have always made these parts more rigid, but yeah, for now, these are fine. The other bit is the spindle router mount. By default, it's only less than half as tall as this one and only uses two screws to attach to the aluminum rail. As such, it does flex when the router and the end mill engage with the material and produce cutting forces, so you get a ton of deflection in here. So yeah, I made that mount longer. I've got two extra screws that bolt this mount to the aluminum profile. That's done. There's a little adapter sleeve in here. I didn't nail the router's diameter first try and it didn't want to reprint everything. There's a ton of material in this thing. Now, on the choice of router or spindle that I made for Bob, there's two, maybe three different types of spindles used in hobby machines. One is this style of trim router. Then there's the low-end brushed and brushless spindles with around 400 watts of power, which are basically just a motor with an ERA living collet screwed on. And then there's the brushless water or air-cooled spindles, typically with a kilowatt or more. Now, aside from form factor, cost, and noise, the biggest factor for whether a spindle is going to work for you is the RPM range, I think. I do like the simple brushless ERA 11 spindle that's now living on the Mendel Max mill, but that only goes up to 12,000 RPM. Sounds like a lot, but because these machines aren't rigid enough to be running, you know, decent size quarter inch or 6mm end mills, the go-to tooling is an 1/8 inch. And that needs to be run quite fast to cut properly. I'm running this single flute end mill at about 20,000 RPM, and I have a feeling that it maybe should even be going a bit faster. The Makita router, trim router I'm using, can be set between 10 and 30,000 RPM, and that range should work for both smaller, you know, 2mm tools, and larger ones if I should want to use a 6mm tool at some point. It's Also a very cheap option actually, since it doesn't need a power supply or a driver or anything. You know, it just plugs into the wall, you have your RPM control right there. But the downside is that the collet it comes with only clamps the largest 6mm end mills, not an eighth of an inch. I know I keep showing you these, but there you go, that's the size difference. You can buy a custom-made 1/8-inch collet for this router specifically, but after shipping and tax, that will cost me basically as much as the entire tool. So for now, I am using these adapter sleeves, which do add a bit of run out, but hey, I mean, if they're good enough for Winston Moy, I'm sure they're good enough for me. If you don't know Winston Moy, go check him out. That guy is a wizard on the carbide 3D machines, which punch in the same weight class as Bob. So okay, that's the router, or quote-unquote spindle, which cuts your workpiece. And by default, you get no option for work holding on Bob. There's no way to tie these, you know, stock parts down, these stock materials down. There is just a slab of Delrin that you get that isn't flat or square with the axes, so you really need some sort of a waste board that you can then mill flat and true in the machine itself. Of course, you could tape something down to the stock Delrin, but I wanted it a bit more secure, so I had Bob mill a few holes into itself, and I then tapped them to M8 to screw down an MDF wasteboard properly. I've also got a few holes that I can use to bolt down a small little machine vise like this. I have been offered an upgraded bed assembly by the folks at CNC Labs. I think that gets rid of the Delrin plate, and that I think was at MRF last year. But because I was only traveling with a light carry-on back then, I couldn't really take those heavy steel parts home with me. You know, maybe at some time in the future, this rail setup might end up in another hard stare down with me. Mechanically, there's not much else to the machine really, other than, you know, I guess the frame. So of course, I modded the frame as well. By default, the only thing keeping this frame square are the corner brackets, these little steel bits right there. And to an extent, the rails and their end pieces, but not a whole lot. There's no diagonal support or anything, so if I whack one of these corners, the entire thing might just end out of square by a millimeter or two. And it actually turned out this thing was out of square, actually, by about that much, a millimeter or two. So I added yet another mod, and you can already see it. There is a bottom piece glued to the entire MDF frame. I cut this square as best as I could, and then just wood glued it to the existing frame while forcing it to line up. I think I may have made access to the open builds wheels of the Y-axis a bit harder, because typically you can just reach through from the bottom, but I can always cut a hole back into the bottom if I need more access. So the last two changes I made were actually much less about the hardware, but more about making better use of the hardware that is now there. I think I've covered all the low-hanging fruit when it comes to improving the mechanics, and anything past that is going to require significant effort for replacing parts and adapting to new ones. So what is left? First, I tried a bunch of different tools, end mills, and, you know, kind of the secret sauce seems to be using a single flute cutter. In fact, CNC Labs had provided me with these two nice shiny 1/8-inch single flute end mills, but just like items in video games, you kind of end up saving up the powerful stuff way too long and never use it. In my case, I'm using these cheaper 1/8-inch end mills. These guys, they come in a 10-pack from China, and they're frankly amazing. They're super sharp and do a great job with chip clearing. What they will allow you to do is to still shave off a decent chip on reasonable cutting parameters without putting too much stress on the kinematics of these rather floppy machines. I like it. Also, no coolant or lubrication or anything. I figured out that if you get your feeds and speeds right, overheating of your part, of your workpiece, and the chip welding and gumming you get from that, like, you know, I got on the shaper test cut that I did right there, that just stops being an issue. So any sort of fluid I'd add to the cut to cool or lubricate would just, you know, end up having the chips stick to the part instead of flying off. And that causes its own set of issues, because you're choking the end mill and you're recutting your chips. If anything, I'd use a bit of compressed air to cool and to clear the chips from deeper holes. But I think the biggest upgrade was actually free. And that was changing away from using SLCAM or Kirimoto to doing CAM in Fusion 360. The recommended CAM for Bob is Kirimoto, which is now available standalone, but if I remember correctly, it used to be only available as a plugin for Onshape. And Onshape changed the license terms so that any form of commercial use, including even what I'm doing with it, requires you to buy a license starting at $1,500 per year. That's as much as buying an entirely new CNC router, like a Shapeoka or something, every year. So it's kind of pointless. With the standalone version, that would be sorted, but it's still a fairly limited tool that treats CNC machines kind of like 3D printers, with the one button auto-generating everything. I guess that can work for softer, non-critical materials, plastics, woods, and that sort of stuff, but you have little control over the exact cuts that are being made. SLCAM is mostly a 2D tool and requires imports and exports of your models, so using Fusion 360 and just being able to pull over designs from the design into the manufacturing workspace is super convenient and efficient. And yeah, it's free, at least for small businesses and hobbyists. And if you do need a license, it is way less expensive than the other options. Oh, and the CAM is actually really, really good. So I spent a bit of time tuning in my settings, and that's what this sample test part is. And I've now got a reliable set of presets for cutting aluminum. And I guess they should also work for cutting, for cutting acrylic and stuff. These are actually leftover bits from the big box. They should also work for hardwood and any, you know, harder material, I guess. For softer materials, I guess I can still crank up the feed rate, and that should, you know, make this machine work. I mean, softer materials aren't that hard to cut. I gotta say, I'm sorry about the not so great quality of these clips. I recorded some of these with my phone, which died right after I was done, so I couldn't grab the original 4K clip. I've only got the compressed 1080p backup. Oh well. So I started, you know, trying things out on this usually pretty horrible rolled aluminum. This is ALMG 0.5 or ALMG 3, 1050 or 6060. And usually it just gums up and mills like crazy. If I can cut this, then I should be able to cut any other grade of aluminum as well. And I think I have achieved that. It's not fast, not that I expect it to be on this machine, but it's a clean enough cut that I'm happy with it, and it's dimensionally okay. The end mill still takes off material after the third spring pass, so I don't know, there is still some work to do. But hey, it's proper aluminum chips on a machine that's built from wood mostly, with some 3D printed parts, bleed screws, and linear rails that barely even qualify as rails, so I'm happy. And it does the job I wanted it to do, to cut some parts for some test jigs that I'll use on the next season of my Filoween tests. I mean, this isn't perfect, but it's looking very, very good, I think. But yes, there is still room for improvement. With the vise mounted and a part in there, the machine basically runs out of Z-travel, and at that tall of a lever arm on the bed, the flex that's still present in the bed kind of multiplies and, you know, makes for some challenges when cutting. Replacing the bed with proper linear rails and a ball screw doesn't seem too hard now, though, especially since I've got the frame closed off at the bottom and I could just screw stuff to that. I also need to rethink this wasteboard. So on the one hand, it's already adding a lot of height to the bed, and height is a limited resource, but this MDF used to be 10 millimeters thick, and after planing it down twice, there are only about 7 or 8 millimeters left, which isn't really enough to screw parts into, so I've always had to screw down into the Delrin base, which is normally not considered a consumable part, so any holes in there are permanent. Also, the lead screws used here, well, they are lead screws, so they have some backlash. The Gerbil firmware, for whatever reason, refuses to include backlash compensation, even Marlin supports that, and the spring-loaded pre-tensioning thingies on the lead screw nuts don't really do a fantastic job either. The spring is too weak to overcome the cutting forces, so you end up with cuts in one direction being pushed by the non-springy part of the nut, which works great, but then cuts the other way are basically dragged along only by the spring, which makes for somewhat inconsistent cuts. I mean, at this point you can get a backlash-free ball screw with proper axial bearings and all instead of relying on the motor as your axial bearings for just about $30. So to me, that is a no-brainer upgrade. Just take some effort to install. But again, the goal was to cut aluminum on this machine, and Bob now cuts aluminum. I think the folks from CNC Labs have learned from the Mill One, because when I look at the long mill, which is the only machine they sell now after the Mill One was discontinued, it looks like pretty much everything I did on this Mill One is already improved or designed differently on the long mill. If you want to know more about that machine, here's the interview that I did with them before it got launched on Kickstarter last year. So yeah, now I have a way to cut aluminum. There's surely more potential for optimization, but for now, this is usable. I'm happy. I hope you guys are safe and sane too. If you enjoy these videos, consider subscribing or even supporting the channel directly. Also, please feel free to tell me in the comments below what I'm still doing wrong with this machine. This is something that I also want to learn more about, because being able to work with metals sometimes is really, really useful. Anyways, friends, thanks for watching, keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one. I've boxed myself in.